you can do all kinds of interesting things with vectors. We can add them tip to tail. We can multiply them by scalars. But one of the things that's really useful that we do with vectors is we use them to find resultants of forces. So if I've got, you know, some kind of a something, hook sticking out of a wall, and I've got a force here. Let me get a little bit bolder. If I've got a force here, and then I have some other force here, and I don't need to make them look like they're in any way interesting. They're completely arbitrary forces, F1 and some force F2. If I want to know what the resultant force is of these two forces, it's the vector sum of the two forces. Oh, I can't spell at all. I don't have the right letters. Of the two forces. Okay, so what I can do is I can take, there's a couple of ways to do this. Let's take this guy. So we want to find, you know, what would be the net force on that little ball. Okay, so one way to do it is to take this guy, and we can use what's called the triangle law. So we have the triangle law, which basically means I can take one of these guys and I can move him here. I'm going to go ahead and leave him there, but I'm going to draw him. I'll make a copy. I know you don't care, but I do. It's important. So I'm going to take him there. So this is the guy that I've kind of moved. And then I can draw the resultant. And I can figure out what this is using geometry. So, you know, somewhere along the way, I'll have a, you know, I'll know what this theta is, which will be slightly different than this theta, or this phi, and I'll know what this psi is. And I might know this length and everything. But anyway, I can use geometry to figure out the length of that green arrow. Okay. Now, alternatively, I can use the parallelogram, which is basically the exact same thing, except with a parallelogram. All kinds of excitement. And in this case, whenever I take this picture here, instead of just moving one of them, I'm going to move both. Okay? So he is going to get moved over here, and this guy here is going to get moved over here, okay? And the resultant is still going to be from here to here, so it's the same resultant, but sometimes, just depending on how your brain's working, sometimes it's just easier to visualize it this way, and sometimes it's easier to visualize it this way. So if you're trying to do stuff with geometry, trying to figure these triangles and parallelograms out. If you've got a triangle drawn and you can't figure it out, try drawing a parallelogram. If you've got the parallelogram and you can't figure it out, try drawing the triangle. Okay? So that's fun. So this would be one way, is to take two forces and add them together and see what we get. Another thing that you're going to be asked to do is to find the components of the force. And you probably have experience doing this in physics 1, and just in general mechanics class, you know, where you have a something like this, and you're like, oh, okay, so this is a force, and it's going up at this angle, whatever. So we want to find the two components. So you've got this component, you've got this component. So if this is some f, then this one is f cosine theta, and this one is f sine theta. Okay? So that's all well and good and kind of easier, I think. But it gets harder if your axes are kind of cattywampus. So this is your, you know, this is a perpendicular coordinate system, and that's the one we usually use. So sometimes you're going to end up in a situation where you don't always have a perpendicular axis. So say we've got, you know, these two struts or something, something like this, and you've got some force just kind of throwing itself out there like this. And then they'll say, well, you know, what is the component of the force on the different struts? So whenever you're looking at a problem like this, what I tend to do is I want to go ahead and extend these axes out like this. Okay. And then what I want to do is I want to say, well, I have to get from here to here. but I'm only allowed to travel on paths that are parallel to here or parallel to here. Well, really parallel to here or parallel to here. Okay, so I'm only allowed to travel along those, not along those axes, but only along paths that are parallel to those axes. So generally what I'm going to do is I'm going to start, well, this is where I want to finish, right? And so I'm just going to pick this direction and say, okay, I can only go parallel to that. Okay, so this is the line that's parallel to, let's call this one, you know, U and V. So this guy is parallel to V, which means it is a legitimate road to take, okay? So I'll draw him another line. So there's my road parallel to V, all right? So now that I'm at V, I can go here. Now I can only travel on roads that are parallel to U, and I can actually travel on U itself. Okay, so if I start at the beginning, and I go this far along U, and this far along V, now I'll end up at the resultant that I'm looking for. So now what I've basically done is I kind of worked backwards and found the two components of that force. And so we'd use geometry to figure out what the lengths of those two components are. Now when you're using geometry, it's really important to remember your basic geometric laws. If you have some generic triangle, so it's not right, it's not isosceles, it's not anything. You have angles C, B, and A. When you're drawing a triangle, we generally call the thing opposite angle A, big A, opposite angle C, big C, and opposite angle B, big B. Or your capitals might be angles, it really doesn't matter. But anyway, you have two laws that are going to be really important. One is the cosine law that says that the length of C is going to be equal to the square root of A squared plus B squared, so it's kind of like the Pythagorean theorem, but it's minus 2AB times the cosine of angle C. Okay, so you probably remember doing that at some point. And then you have the sine law, which says that A is to the sine of A, as B is to the sine of B, as C is to the sine of C. Okay. So in general, if you have any three of these items, if you have any two sides and an angle, or any, you know, one side and a whatever, as long as you have at least one length and at least one angle, you're usually in pretty good shape that you can find all the other missing pieces of your triangle. It's just a question of getting it drawn right. So I'd really recommend whenever you're working these problems is, you know, if you're looking at this and it's not making any sense, draw the other half of the parallelogram and see if you can find some angle that way. Because something just might not be popping out at you because of your perspective. But if you play with it around a little bit, it might make a little bit more sense.